W pierwszych słowach tak dziwnie podziękuję mojej studentce.
Thank you for the invitation to the conference. And first of all, I would like to appreciate my student for underlying drive to research sexual behaviors amongst young people on the internet. On several occasions, I wanted to give up because it was a huge challenge. But she kept pushing on. It was a challenge because many questionnaires that we used in the day in our research were incomplete. Out of the 1,000 questionnaires, only 350 were suitable for final processing. So there was a huge work and a lot of time wasted, and I felt discouraged. But on the other hand, I represent an older generation, and when young people speak about sexuality, they take some things for granted. And I still feel that I'm blushing despite my age when I hear such things. So things are changing. How things are changing and how young people react. When we approached this project, first we wanted to identify concepts of sexuality or concepts related to sexuality. And these concepts are very different. So sexting, cyber sex, sponsoring, pornophily, grooming that is on the sideline, but nevertheless, it's in the backdrop. And we were actually trying to approach these concepts from the definition point of view. So we didn't want to take just the term, but we wanted to explore it. And on top of it, we wanted to look at it from different angles. First of all, do young people know what these terms mean? Because it turned out that, you know, they use terms and because they heard them being said in the media, but they are not quite sure what the specific term actually means. We were also trying to find out whether the concepts that we study are truly prevalent amongst young people, and whether our respondents are really engaging in such behaviors. And on the final note, we wanted to uncover the opinions of the respondents, whether they approve or disapprove of such behaviors. Because if I approve some behaviors, if I say that my friend show up, you know, in the network and the whole school is talking about it, well, even if I approve it, it doesn't mean that I would do the same or I would behave in the same manner. So we also seen some divergence here. So a few words about the methodology. The study was conducted online. And as I explained, we were not able to attain the large set of complete questionnaires, but we wanted to guarantee anonymous participation, because we knew that young people would have concerns whether their data is disclosed or not. So we used this anketa.pl, questionnaire.pl portal that is a guarantee of the anonymity. So young people could actually fill it in, and they could be assured that whatever they put in the questionnaire would never be disclosed to their teachers or whoever. So this is the first survey. So I will discuss preliminary findings. And since it was hard to get enough respondents, we didn't use the random sample. I targeted junior high students. And I identify three categories of schools, technical school, high school, and the other vocational schools. And another gender, another criterion that we followed was gender, so either female or male. To start with this discussion, we had the opening question, namely, what information about sexuality is available to young people? And we don't have the answer, I don't have access, because there were no answers like that. The usually say, I have easy access or I have somewhat difficult access. So perhaps parents control what I do on the internet, or I have to log in. There are some access criteria to access some materials. But to be quite honest, I was surprised that no one said that they had no access to such data. Pornography in the net. Well, you may define that in different ways, but two-thirds of young people claim that they can easily access pornography. And again, this is a junior high group. So it means that we start at the age of 15, but some of the respondents were pushing their 20s. Now, erotic classified ads that are in the net. Well, 50% of the respondents said that such ads are easily available and accessible. And then when we explored reasons why they accept such behaviors, was that young people approved of the fact that this is something that brings money. Every 10 respondents said that this is something that makes money. This is something that will bring you income. And therefore, they review sex ads online. And they may respond to some sexual proposals. And the last category is somewhat controversial. But we wanted to ask the question whether young people really feel that there is availability of cybersex in the net. And it turned out that 35% of the respondents said yes. And it's fairly easy to do it. It's fairly easy to get such an opportunity. So as I said, my first question was to check whether they are familiar with the definition, whether they know what definition means. So the whole exercise or the whole question was such that we had a series of complete definitions and terms, and the respondents were asked to combine the text with the term. And it was not possible to attribute two definitions to one term. So it was fairly easy. I didn't ask an open question, what is it? They just had to read the definition and link it to the right term. So 72% recognized sponsoring and grooming. Why? Because my explanation is that we hear a lot about it. So they had a lot of exposure to these terms. And these terms are discussed so commonly that young people are actually familiar with the definition. But sexting was a surprise to many of them. It appears that sexting has been around for 2 or 3 years. This is the sort of topic that pops up in different areas, for instance, in the area of school preventive interventions. But a fairly small percentage of respondents were able to define sexting. And I also use Kimberly Young's test to use internet abuse, so to speak. And people who excessively use internet or are actually threatened by abusive behavior or dependence or addiction, they are dysfunctional users of internet. And then when I separated these two groups in the study, we actually noticed that these two groups participate in some concept almost on a one-to-one basis. But when it comes to pornophony, here the statistical significance was rather moderate. In case of other terms, there were no statistical correlations. So the fact that someone excessively uses internet does not really impact this picture. We may not come to the straightforward conclusion, okay, he's an excessive user of the internet, so he certainly has a problem with some sexual things. Well, we spoke about gender. We heard that girls are more sensitive to certain developments or certain phenomena, but statistical significance was noted only for sponsoring and grooming. For other categories, it didn't matter what was the gender of the respondent. So both boys and girls had the same capacity to come up with a definition of the terms. And the types of schools, because it was one of our criteria. Well, prior to the studies, I thought that vocational schools would be at the top. then technical schools would be ranked number two and high school number three. It turned out that the situation was completely different. Kids from high schools were most fluent with the definitions. Kids from technical schools were coming second, and vocational schools were the poorest when it came to defining the terms. Now, another question was, are young people coming across such phenomena in their school environment? My point was whether they actually see it amongst their peers at school. So whether such information is something that is being discussed with their schoolmates. It turned out that yes, pornophony turned out to be the most prevalent. So it is the most common thing amongst junior high students. Grooming was also ranking high. And we may say that since this is about like, I know what grooming means, but grooming targets younger children. So young people that we surveyed claimed that grooming is not something that really relates to them. Looking at the data and looking at gender, the only significant statistical relation was with cybersex. So twice as many girls claim that there is cybersex in their school. Twice as many girls than boys. In other categories, gender didn't matter. So when we want to differentiate between dysfunctional group and groups without dysfunctions, it turned out that pornophony and grooming was often selected by people from dysfunctional group. And they claimed that such phenomena are actually present in their school environment. Another slide and a similar picture. When we look at the different types of schools, again, general high school number one, technical high school number two, and vocational school number three. And next question was, have you ever come across? And we had like 50 different statements. Not all of them were about sexuality, because the first question was, have you ever come across the proposal to have a meeting in the real world? It doesn't imply sexuality, but it may be the first step towards some sexual engagement. And 50% of respondents said that yes, they came across such a situation. Being persuaded to talk about sex, 40% said that they were subject to such actions. In several situations, respondents were able to complete and offer more facts, and it turned out that they understand that as an encouragement. So shifting from the general discussion to the discussion or conversation about sexuality. So the pressure of the other person is being perceived as a certain sort of proposal or suggestion to start speaking about sexuality. Request to send an erotic picture or video, 29%. Sexual fantasies of another person, 28%. And the remake of the picture or rendering of the picture for some defamatory purposes. Again, it is not necessarily for sexual purposes. But when respondents were describing what they meant was, for instance, placing someone's face on the nude picture and then posting it on the internet. So this is the table with the answers. And let me just highlight one line. Proposals to perform sexual activities. 90% said that they met with such proposals. So every fifth respondent was approached with a proposal to actually perform some sexual activities in real world. And mind you, these are young people who are becoming more mature, who reach some level of sexuality. And in a sense, I understand that I have to speed up. If I speak too fast, please let me know. So we may say that they live in two worlds. And to them, the world of sexuality that is being controlled by teachers and parents shifted to the network. They go to the internet to search for their sexuality because on the internet they are free from parental control. All of us have different definition of acceptable social sexual behaviors. But here we've got a set of answers and another line. Some gratification for sharing erotic pictures or videos. 6% said that they were approached with such proposal. So it's not a high number, but nevertheless, it's obvious that such things happen. And then we asked the respondents to describe their own behaviors. And here we had two categories. What I get, so when I am the receiver, and who is the receiver of the content, myself or my friends? And let me speak about the respondents. 5% of the respondents claimed that they were getting some intimate multimedia messages from other people. 9% claimed that they would be getting MMSs with intimate content. Today, when young people speak about a boyfriend or a girlfriend, this is not a sustainable relationship. They may have a new boyfriend or a girlfriend every day. So the number of possible boyfriends or girlfriends is being quite sizable. It's not just one person. So when we look at the behaviors that they perform, 11% of the respondents claimed that they send their intimate pictures or videos to their boyfriends or girlfriends. Every 10th person used websites such as ShowUp. So again, there is some financial motivation in the backdrop. Now, approval and disapproval. Let me focus on behaviors that were most accepted and approved and positively enforced. Discussions about the sexual topics, 22% said that they approve it, using pornography. Every 5th person said that this is okay, that this is a standard thing and this should be accepted. And then some other criteria that you will find for further reading. And then I wanted to see whether there is a relation between getting the sexual videos and getting the proposals with some sexual undertone. And here the relation is actually statistically significant, but moderate. So there is some relation between excessive use of the internet and such things. So I had to skip some slides, but young people say and explain what are the reasons for risk sexual behaviors. Well, most of them said that they do it out of curiosity and they want to try new things. But 14% say that they are interested in sex and this is how they want to meet their sexual needs, that they see when they become sort of more mature. So I'm taking it to the extreme, but what we see here is that young people believe that they should take their sexual needs to the internet. So, you know, they believe that this is something that they have the right to do because they are young. This is the experience of the life. So 12% said that they have financial motivation, others want to show off, but another interesting point is that 9%, so almost every 10th respondent said that, well, parents are to blame because the way they raised me, they forced me to look for things in the internet. I cannot talk to them, so I will seek my answers in the internet. There was an old Polish movie about a dad who was trying to get prepared for the sex talk with his son. He was reading books, but when he started to speak to his son said, come on, stop it. I've known about it for a long time. So it seems that, again, we revisit the old story. Parents are not prepared to do their job. And when we have a parent and a young child or a young teen, it turns out that the teens have already found out everything on their own, either on the internet or from their peers. And now the classes about sexual upbringing and things like that. Well, obviously, we talk about the risk that they may face in the internet, but this is the general discussion. I wanted to find out about Facebook. And I have to tell you, my daughter was teaching me how to use Facebook. And today, she's my source of intelligence because we have very good relationship. So she actually is sharing a lot of things with me. I would never be able to research such things if I didn't have a preview to their world through my daughter. So she's my research consultant. She explains to me where certain things are considered a standard or where this is pathology. Cyberbullying, 53%, and identity theft, also 30%. So every fifth person says that such topics were discussed, but at a very general way. So the conclusion is such that sexuality of young people is an important thing. How they are being raised is being truly important. And the role of the parent and of the educator is critical. Parents and educators should explain what is the difference between the real world and the cyber world, and what is the appropriate thing here and there. Thank you.